And here we go, fight fans. Making his way out to the blue corner for your co-main event, please welcome Hernani Perpetuo.
All right, Hernani Perpetuo, now a record of 20-8. And it's interesting, in my experience, I've seen quite a few shows. I remember commentating a show in Grand Rapids, and it was the first time, you know, this is, gosh, over a decade ago, but seeing the Brazilians come in, and it was just another level. Yep. It was just the guys that had equal experience, but they go through wars in the gym, yep. Not just in fights and their opponents. It's much like Ontario, where it's very evenly matched. You're not padding records.
That's
these guys
right.
are fighting and battling. You know, they're having smokers. I mean, there's just so much experience coming through when you come from Brazil.
And even, you know, when they're sparring, they're fighting.
It's a battle,
know?
Right?
Yeah. And there's, hey, listen, fighting is physical, it's mental, it's emotional, but there's an essence to martial arts, a spirit, you know? And many of these Brazilian fighters carry that, you know, you feel the emotion, you feel their comfort, you feel that they belong here. And guys like Hernani, some of these guys come up very poor, where fighting and martial arts is their ticket to a different life as well. So it isn't a game to them. It's not, you know, they're not coming out and competing in a contest. This is their life, right? This is their life. And I've called a few of Hernani's fights for Judo Brazil, for some Fight Pass fights, and he's a very intense guy. You know, he's not mean, he's not ornery, but he's trying to hurt you. He's trying to knock you unconscious or choke you unconscious. He's hyper aggressive. This is a heavy fight for Elias Theodoro.
And his opponent, making his way out to the red corner, please welcome Elias Theodoro.
So Elias Theodoro, we haven't had a chance to say this on the broadcast, but last fight, UFC Ottawa. I mean, you know, this is the caliber that we're talking about right now. First Canadian Tough winner, and that's spectacular. That's, you know, a title that you have and
forever.
That can carry on forever. Yeah. I mean, that's legendary stuff, right?
Yeah, this is a real great fighter. He's a real great human being, man. He really is. And there's something about the way he fights that there's a lot of tension. It's a strange, different style. He's hard to hit, he's hard to read, but he's on the edge. Like you feel like he could be knocked out at any time because of the nature of how on the edge he is, how close he is to getting hit, but it's part of his style. He's hard to touch, he's hard to find. He'll wear you out, you know, but he fights on the edge.
And how lucky, Prospect Fighting Championship, to have him here on the stage here in Windsor, Ontario, at the University of Windsor, St. Denis Center. I mean, it's really cool. And for him to be from Toronto as well. I mean, it's really unique that we get a chance to have this.
People have really misunderstood his style. A lot of people have done him a disservice when they've described it. Joe Rogan is one of the great commentators in any sport ever, and Joe understood how his unorthodox nature and him being off balance all the time is what makes his fighting style. It's very hard to read, it's very hard to process, but he's only millimeters away from being knocked unconscious all the time. And there's an incredible tension to it, but when people talk about it, they often say that there's nothing happening, there's not a lot of punches thrown. But if you understand what he's doing, he's fighting with great tension, and he's fighting on a razor's edge at all times. He's in danger, and so are you.
This is a great co-main event right before the title fight for us to get a chance to see this and these two great athletes in action. And I think it's like what you said. You can already feel the tension, what these two are bringing to the table.
Here we go, PFC Fight fans. The following contest is your co-main event of the evening. Scheduled for 3 rounds in the middleweight division, this contest is being brought to you by Herb Angels, Cafe, USG Canada, and Sovereign Extracts. Introducing your fighters. First, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks trimmed in white. Standing 6 feet 1 inch tall, he weighed in at 185.4 pounds. He's a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt representing Nova Unio Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. He comes to the PFC cage with a record of 20 wins and only 8 losses. Fighting out of and representing Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, here is UFC veteran Hernani Perpetuo. His opponent across the cage, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black trunks trimmed in gray and white. Standing 6'1" tall, he weighed in at 185.4 pounds. He's a freestyle mixed martial artist representing Rival MMA. He comes to the PFC cage with a record of 16 wins and only 3 losses, with 2 wins coming by way of submission and 6 big wins coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of Toronto, Ontario, by way of Mississauga, Ontario, ladies and gentlemen, here is UFC veteran, the main event, Elias the Spartan Theodoro. Referee Brian Beauchamp with final fight instructions.
Gentlemen, we're over my instructions in the back room. I want a clean, fair fight. If I ask you to stop, stop everything you're doing, touch gloves, go back to your corner.
Ladies and gentlemen, this middleweight co-main event will be decided in 3 rounds or less.
You almost wonder, if you're from Brazil, you have to know BJJ. It's like Canadians, you have to know how to skate. It's like you're just an obligation.
Yeah, it is.
Perpetuo coming out, just a blast. Trying to do something funky just to create the confusion and ends up with his back on the cage.
But I think he was trying a flying knee. Oh, that knee woke Elias up for sure. Of course, if you land that flying knee and the fight is over, that's great. And if you don't, or you land it glancing like he did, maybe off the shoulder, you end up here. And Elias is very good here. He's a very good wrestler. He's been training a ton of wrestling with Guelph and Chad Pearson, his wrestling coach. And he doesn't mind being in this position, for sure.
Well, it's one of those tricky things. You know, you want to be on top as the wrestler, but then do you want the black belt on his back where he's very comfortable? It's kind of like, you know, a ground game battle when you see the wrestler and the jiu-jitsu.
Elias has dealt with a lot of black belts in that position. And I, from experience, I think he'd rather be there than out in the open with a guy throwing kicks at his head.
Or flying knees or
flying
anything
knees,
you can't anticipate or expect, right? And just jockeying for position.
He will wear you down here, too. The dude does not, I mean, he fatigues like all humans, but he just handles it so incredibly well. He's going to be in better shape than everybody he fights, and he's fought at the top level, and he's in better shape than the fighters that he fights, and you see it in the third round. And if he had his way, he would fight like this for 12, 14 minutes, and then he'd start to really beat you up.
You know, good job bringing the knee upstairs and just not letting you get away with anything if you're with your back in the cage.
Nope. Now, Elias has both his, and you know, you'll hear the term double underhook, but essentially all that means is both his arms are underneath your armpits and around your back. And that's it's an ultimate position here because, oh, this is what he wants for sure. Now, the butterfly hooks by Hernani, the feet inside the thighs, he's going to try to, like, destabilize Elias. But Elias is cool here. This is a position he likes.
He kind of rolled an up kick and tried to weave his way through his legs, but, you know, kind of more cautious of it now.
This is exactly what you want to do. You kick these legs repeatedly until he moves, and you don't, you're not in a rush to get through this. You can kick. That's allowed. If I'm Elias, I'm still kicking. It doesn't matter if your man's talking to the ref. You know, it's important to just take advantage of whatever errors he makes. And if he's distracted and speaks to the ref, you keep kicking.
Yeah, Elias just relentless, trying to get on top of him and trying to work that position.
Yeah, and he wants no space here, right? So he's going to try to trap the arm, not there. But he wants his hips as close to Hernani as possible. Hernani keeps putting his shin in there and using it to elevate Elias and make space. But Elias loves this position. If he could have written this fight and you'd say to him, 3 minutes in, you'd be on top of a guy, and maybe you'd start to be fatiguing him, he would take this every day of the week. This is how he'd like this fight to look.
You know, and you can hear Hernani's corner trying to instruct him through this, to try and take advantage of anything that Elias will give him, but he's so top-heavy that he's struggling. Coming around the back, but still Elias ending up on top.
Watch up kicks here. These up kicks are available to Hernani here. And we were talking about it earlier tonight. It's been an overlooked aspect of the game. You really, fighters and coaches should be training up kicks with pads. You should be training fighters to land up kicks, to throw them, to control them, because they're there often. We've sort of dismissed them, but they're a tool. And Hernani's got that tool available to him right now.
You know, and for him, just using it more to push him off and create space. And now he kind of wants, you know, what he wants. It's to be stood up, but the ref isn't biting because they're just too active, and Elias is, you know, getting his position.
Hernani's going to attack first the knee and then the heel in all likelihood. First the knee. There's 45 seconds left. You can pop soft tissue that stabilized the knee in 4 seconds, in 2 seconds. So this is a long time to have a position here for Hernani. Smart. Those matter, right? They're unpleasant, they're distracting.
And those are huge, yeah, distracting in terms of not letting him play defense.
Yep. Elias now likes this. He can punch with the right arm here, and he should be. But no, he's going to, now he's in a position to do it. So this is a round that Elias will be very pleased with. With 16 seconds left, trying to cut his man from the top position. He's learned that he can handle this man's grappling on the ground, can handle him on the fence. If this round ends, the first 30 seconds of round two will be the most dangerous 30 seconds of the remainder of the fight.
Yes, exactly. We know how Hernani's going to come out, and he's going to ensure that he's not stuck in this position again, right?
Yep. And he's
that was 5 rounds of him carrying Elias's weight.
5 minutes, yeah.
5 minutes, yeah.
It was. Yeah, and Elias will not be fatigued now. And Hernani, he's turned his back to Elias. That's a choice many fighters make. But we can see directly into his face. He's taken deep breaths. He's got a cut on his nose. Like, he's been through it a little bit there.
And so, what he's going to have to do if he ends up in that same position again, he can't be that calm, cool, collective, jiu-jitsu practitioner. He has got to do some blitzes. He's got to move fast and scramble so that he can get back to his feet.
Well, and, you know, it would be better to just not get there, right? Like, even better than that, it's great, you know, is to keep this space now. So let's face it. If he looks back at that round, in retrospect, the flying knee was an error. Right? Of course, if you land it, it's not an error. You won the fight. It was the smartest thing anyone's ever seen. But this time, don't be surprised if he's not in a rush and he dances from the outside kicking Elias's legs. That's what you'd tell him to do.
Yeah, right? And I think it's one of those things you're anticipating. Elias is looking for the takedown right away, right off the rip, and you thought that knee would work.
Yep. So watch, Hernani's going to be a lot slower this time. See, backing up already.
Yeah, and he's just getting pushed without even punches or anything, getting pushed back to the cage. Two head kicks from both sides, and then regaining his space so he can land some more of those kicks.
Yep.
You know, knocking a mouthpiece out of Elias, the one actually that was doing the kicking.
Spit it out. So those kicks actually worked really well. And now he goes downstairs. He'll go upstairs again with the right kick. I can see him setting it. There it is.
Well, and he does a great job at finding space for that. He doesn't smother his kicks, and he throws them from out there.
And think of what he's doing. He wants Hernani to come towards him. From this range, he's the longer fighter. He's kicking, which means Hernani, to do anything, must move forward. If he moves forward, Elias moves forward as well and gets the body lock. It's brilliant, actually.
And there's that awkwardness that you were talking about, some looping overhand to look for the kick, you know, distract them. And that's that, ref got in the way.
Yep, the ref got in the way, and it is what it is. You know, this is an aspect of the fight game. You can't panic, you can't freak out, you accept that we're in this position and you work your way out of it.
Well, and it's funny because they were moving forward and really reversed the direction they were going pretty quickly.
You definitely. Those up kicks are in play. They're not now when your knees are on the ground. They'd be an illegal strike now. But, if you told Elias he'd be in round two on top of his man, he'd be pretty happy finding that out. So he's got to be settled in here, happy with how this is going.
Well, and you're noticing the conditioning difference. Elias just looks like, you know, he's in his flow, where Hernani looks exhausted. And that's how he seemed to come out in round number two.
Right. And when Your flow is never better than when you're in places they're of comfort. And this is a place of comfort for Elias. He's not in danger here. He's going to stay centered in the guard. Hernani's going to look to try to isolate the right arm. Or maybe try to sweep here. There are sweeps that are available from here, but mostly he's just trying to shut down Elias's attack here. And if you're...
And Elias doing a good job of trying to always give damage, right? He's trying to posture up, get some more damage, drop some elbows, because you know that's going to cut somebody open and distract them. Yep. And just, you know, that's all it takes for the ref is high volume. It is just let your hands go, get some of those big shots
in. Up kicks are there now. Up kicks are there. That's, you, again, those up kicks are so dangerous, and they're always there. People are starting to see them now.
He's got to just pull the hands away so he can land some of these clean just to impress the ref. And oftentimes that's what it takes, right, is making sure he can see those clean shots landing in high volume.
Yep. Again, you can kick the legs here. That's, you know, you take what's there. You don't force things.
Oh, big.
Sliced it through, Yep.
And because he does a good job of distracting you before he throws it. Like he's going to do something else, almost like a feint, right?
Yep. And even these shots are heavy. This is, and he can stay here for a long time doing them. He wants a finish tonight, too.
Yeah.
He's got 2 minutes in this round to try to get it. And then...
And I feel like the ref is just seconds away because he's just saying to himself, you know, Hernandez got to really defend or make it look like he wants to get out of this position.
Yep. Advance his position. Yep. And Elias might just hammer his way through, Donkey Kong his way through this one.
Well, I think he's got to go body head. He's got to look to the side of his body and start mixing it up so he can pull those hands away. In boxing especially, we'll pull a hand away and then fire. And that's what you want to try and do is create that space.
His up kick is there again. His up kicks are there. That is that's the one major threat.
Oh.
There it is. You know, nobody should be ever forgetting that there's a man on the, when you're moving towards a guy, there's a guy on the ground where his entire body can take the heel bone and jam it into your temple or jaw.
Well, Elias does a good job of staying extremely tall. Like he doesn't shoot in head first. He makes sure that his head's not in line for that. And then see how he controls the feet when his head is lower.
So you want to come in hips and chest first. And that's what he's doing right there. It's a hips, chest, right? And he settles back in here, and he'll do 45 seconds more of damage, looking to try to finish. But if it's not there, he'll just take what he's got. This is a really, I think he went elbow to the sternum there as well. That's heavy. There's a lot happening here. Not just is he hurting the man, that's one. Not just is he winning the round, that's two. But he's fatiguing him. He's making him less of an opponent for round three as well.
Well, you're seeing almost the jiu-jitsu just escape Hernani because he's being hit so much.
Watch
he's
for a head kick. Elias will definitely go head kick here.
Well, and he mixed it up, right? Body, head, body, moving it up, moving it down. All he's thinking about is damage.
Yep. He knows his man's fatigued. It was actually a brilliant choice to get him up for 20's head kick.
Oh, great slips right there.
He tried the inside kick, spinning elbow.
And that's what, if you keep providing variety, your opponent has no idea how to play defense on you.
You just overload his mind with possibilities, right? So, I mean, your brain starts to go on default. It's like did you ever play pinball when you were a kid?
Yes.
You know, most people,
I had the thing decades back.
Anyone under 20 probably doesn't even know what pinball is, but the machine goes on tilt where it just stops working. It gets overloaded and it goes on tilt. That's what Elias is looking to do. He's looking to set Hernani's machine to tilt.
I really liked, you know, the head kicks that he brought to the table. I think he'd have more success. I mean, he's doing so well on the ground, and we're seeing that he's not getting enough clean shots on the ground in terms of wanting the ref to stop it, because you can see that's his objective, right?
But
he's just not getting...
seeing Hernani's face, and when he turns, and if the ref or if the camera catches it, there's two big lumps in the middle of his head.
You know, it wouldn't be a surprise for the ref to stop it and let the doctor check it out, you know, something like that, because it could split open.
Yeah.
But Elias has just done an incredible job from start to finish.
But
it really worn Hernani down from the beginning. Yep. So Elias with the braided hair and Hernani.
The fight is not over by any stretch of the imagination. Hernani is a dangerous guy. When he commits to any shot, a right hand, it'll be primarily a right hand at this point as you're beat up. That's what you're looking at.
But the thing is with Elias, he kicks and he's out of range, right? He kicks and then he half step back and then he gives himself that space so that someone, even if you were to respond to it, he's out of space.
Hernani did exactly what you'd want him to do, and that is he threw multiple punches mid-kick. Took the kick, but walked his way in and threw multiple punches. That's what he wants to do here, right? Well, it's hard to do when you just took a shin off the arm, but during the kick, he wants to go in with three punches, right? Or during one of those, right? Yeah.
Well, and I think he's got to go to the low leg kick. Like, when he throws that, you know, the kind of pawing jab, he's got to look for that low leg kick.
So if Elias pulls him up now, he can knee him, or instead go around, you've got a fatigued guy, and get him back down here. Hernani just looked for a sweep there, just tried to swing the leg out and create a little momentum and
position before punching. Yeah. This is him right now. Get him up against the cage where he's kind of locked out.
There's also an element where you are just physically throwing somebody around. Sometimes we call it little brothering him. It's mentally tough. You've been beaten up. You're tired. You're sore. You can't see. And now somebody's little brothering you, and they don't feel like they're... And look at just blading his own hip to pass there as Elias.
And the thing is, Elias has been so busy that Hernani hasn't had even an opportunity to look for submissions.
Hey, listen, man. This is an amazing performance from Elias. His first fight after being cut by the UFC, and the ref just said, that's enough. Come back and fight another day. And I think maybe, and he just pointed, maybe there's a big cut. He's just like, I don't believe you can win this fight anymore.
Yeah.
And so he's
I mean, it would be different if he was trying to sink in submissions, if you started to see him go for some submissions, but we weren't seeing that. We were just seeing kind of pure defense
he
and
couldn't.
Not advancing his position. So that was a smart move.
Yep. Elias just picked him up and said thank you. Elias has got to feel good now. You know, he got cut by the UFC after a single loss, and he was on a roll, and he was accepting fights with tough, top 10 guys. And then he loses to a top 5 guy, and they cut him, truthfully, because they don't understand his style. And that's not cool, my friend. It's not. He's a martial artist winning contests with a unique style. And just because many of us are not educated enough to understand it, they end up cutting him. That's wrong. I'm glad that he's back here. I'm glad that he had a wonderful performance, and I'm glad he appreciates Hernani coming in here.
And I think that's what brought this performance. It was like, I want to get back there, and it didn't matter where he was. He was trying to drop leather, and you could tell that that was important to him.
Well, I know my friend Rich Chow, who's a matchmaker for Bellator, may have been watching tonight. He was sent a link, and I'm sure he liked what he saw with Elias if he was watching. If you are, Rich, hello, my friend. Thank you for watching. I'm going to go in and talk to Elias, Kara.
Ladies and gentlemen, clap your hands for both of the fighters in this cage. Referee Brian Beauchamp steps in to stop this contest at 1 minute, 51 seconds of the third round for your winner by TKO, Elias the Spartan Theodoro.
Hey, baby. How are you, man? You're smiling. That was vintage Elias Theodoro, and then some. You were ornery, you were aggressive, you gave him nothing, and not only were you outmoving him, but you were wearing him down. The fight was becoming easier. You gotta be happy with everything.
Yeah, definitely happy. Like you said, very much going back to my roots. I gotta thank my coaches, all of them, RG, Chad Pearson, and what's all the Garvin, Dave Garvin, and also Evan Boris in the stands, and everyone else has kind of gotten me on where I am, including your fine self.
Well, man, I couldn't be happier for you. That's a heavy dude right there. I commentated a couple of his fights when he was in Shooto, Brazil. He was a champion. He just overwhelmed that man. It looked like you were trying to really make an important statement about where you are and what your future is.
That's very true. Honestly, I know I'm one of the best in the world, and I think I've helped prove it, and I'm going to continue doing that. And very much just kind of taking taking what I want from each opponent moving forward. So I'm excited to get my hand raised, and I'm looking to get back in there as soon as possible to get my hand raised again and in finishing fashion again.
Well, I'm really happy for you. A lot of people sponsor you and stuff, so say things into this mic.
Well, first and foremost, I want to thank everyone that helped to get me in here, obviously. Herb Angel, who's one of the key sponsors here, Cafe. I also want to thank On the Run Meals, who gets me to 185 and then back up again. Wiseman, who again puts the hair together. We got hemp energy drink. I run on compliments and energy drinks, as my girlfriend would say. Also, again, I want to thank, again, I do get hit in the head, Venus Heel as well. They put together my body and everyone else. Honestly, it takes an army to get ready for war, and I couldn't be more thankful for my team who have seen me victorious in the end of the year and looking forward to be victorious in the new year.
I couldn't be happier for you, my friend. Congratulations. Please put your hands together for your winner. Welcome back, Elias Theodoro. Much love.